The first passage of scripture we're going to read out of is Exodus chapter 16, verses 1 through 5. And Exodus chapter 16, verses 1 through 5. It says in this passage of scripture, "And they took their journey from Elim, and all the congregation of the children of Israel came unto the wilderness of Sin, which is between Elim and Sinai, on the 15th day of the second month, after their departing out of the land of Egypt. And the whole congregation of the children of Israel murmured against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. And the children of Israel said unto them, Would to God," that's old King James language for saying, "I wish God would have just let us die." But that's what they're saying. "I just wish he would have. Would to God we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the flesh pots, and when we did eat bread to the full." So in other words, what they're saying right there, just to break it down for you, I like using the King James Version. I got to explain that to you every time. If you want to know why I use the King James, you can watch a video called A Lamp in the Dark. Okay, there's a reason why I do. All right. But anyway, the King James Version. What to God? Wish he just would have left us in Egypt. So basically what they're saying is, I wish he just would have left me as a slave where I was before. See, Egypt, we've said it many times in our services, Egypt is a type of the world. How many of you have been saved out of the world? Amen? How many of you given your heart to the Lord? If you have, you know what I'm talking about. If you haven't given your heart yet, that's okay. I'm going to try to break it down for you. When you're born the first time like your father Adam, you're born into the world. You're born a sinner. That's what the Bible teaches. Amen? And so Egypt in the Old Testament is a type of the world system. And Pharaoh is a type of the enemy of your soul. And Pharaoh held God's people in bondage. But yet God sent a deliverer named Moses to deliver the people out of Egyptian bondage. Just as God sent a deliverer, Moses is a type of Jesus. Hallelujah. And listen to me, it gets even deeper than that, because the night that God delivered Israel out of Egyptian bondage, a feast called the Passover was instituted. People that have been coming for a while are very familiar with this concept, but for some of you that aren't, the Passover feast was instituted on the night that God delivered Israel out. If you've ever seen the movie The Passion of the Christ, then the very first scene of the movie, it shows Mary, the mother of Jesus, and Mary Magdalene sitting in a room, and it says, "Why is this night like no other night?" And the other one responds, "Because we once were slaves and now we're free." What they were talking about was, if that night was Passover night. No, this is too good. I feel the Holy Spirit on this already. It's not even in my notes. This is just too good to pass up. Because you see, the God that wrote this word and communicates himself to humanity had already pre-written the script long in advance before you and I would ever show up on the face of the earth. And man just treats this book like it's another book to be thrown on a shelf and to collect dust. But if you dare open it up and begin to understand it, what you begin to realize is that he's actually written the story twice. Paul said that they were examples for us. So what happened to them happened for a reason that even New Testament Christians would be able to understand and see what happened. Well, what happened on that night? What that scene was saying is they were remembering back to the Passover night. Well, what happened on the Passover night? On the Passover night, God told Moses, "Take a lamb, cut its throat, collect its blood. Then I want you to come over here with that basin of blood, and I want you to get some hyssop," which is kind of like a plant that was absorbent. Well, let's use this door. "And I want you to strike the side post and the door post with blood on the lintels and on the top." And well, it does make a sign. It does end up making a sign of the cross when you look at it like that, but that's another story. But I want you to put blood on the door, and said, "I'm going to send judgment on the land. And whenever the death angel comes through, when I see the blood, I will pass over you." Meaning, death and judgment will not come upon the house where the people are on the inside eating the lamb that's been roasted with fire. Fire is a type of God's judgment. The judgment through the fire was put upon the lamb and not put upon the people. And when God saw the blood, he passed over and allowed his judgment to be passed over. Fast forward to that movie scene that I was trying to tell you about. 2,000 years later, on the Passover night, Jesus was betrayed. Paul said he is our Passover lamb. God had a plan that the lamb that on the Passover night was a type of Jesus who was going to die on the cross, shed his blood, And when you and I learn to put our faith in that, hallelujah, the judgment that was really for us was placed on him. He paid the penalty for our sin, and we get to be set free. And just as the children of Israel exited Egypt, God delivers us out of the world system. Amen. And so here's the children of Israel in this part of the story, that they've been delivered out of Egyptian bondage. But what they're doing is, I was talking to the old boy across the street before service. What they're doing is that they're remembering the good old days. They're looking back and they're starting to get a little bit hungry. They're on the journey and they feel like they're running out of bread. They're getting a little bit thirsty. They don't know where they're going to get water. And they're starting to look around and said, man, I just wish God would have let us die in Egyptian bondage. It was better when we were slaves. How many times have people given their heart to Jesus and then whenever things don't go the way that they want them to, they remember all the good times in the world back when they were in the world? Oh, they forgot all the bad times. They forgot all the times how old boy treated them he wasn't really that good to you. Or old girl wasn't really that good to you. He really did you dirty if you stop and think about it. Had your heart broken multiple times because you trusted people and they kept on messing you up, kept on hurting you. You didn't look back on the days whenever you used to go hang out in the club and everything was all cool and everything, but really and truly it wasn't really all that cool because there was a lot of pain connected to it. A lot of bad things that happened. But what we tend to do is we just remember all the good times and we don't remember the bad times. And what they're saying is, we'd rather been slaves in Egypt than to come out here. And that's what's going on. Back whenever we had flesh pots, meaning meat was cooked in the pot, and we had plenty of meat to eat. We had bread to fill us up, right? And so he says right here, going into the next verse, for you have brought us forth into this wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger. That's what the people are starting to look at Moses. Why did God bring us out here? It's your fault, Moses. You brought us out here, and you're trying to kill us with hunger. Why didn't you just leave us over there when they had plenty of meat in the pot, and they had plenty of bread to eat? Then said the Lord unto Moses, behold, I will rain bread from heaven for you, and the people shall go out and gather a certain rate every day, that I may prove them. Now, with the word prove there, literally, I can tell you, I didn't even look it up, but I know I've said it enough. It means to put them to the test. God, you understand, wants to put us to the test. In other words, he's not a hard taskmaster, but anytime you give your heart to the Lord, anytime you make a decision to live for God, there's a constant ongoing situation where he tests you. He allows tests to take place in the midst of our life. And the thing of it is that sometimes we fail tests. Sometimes we fail tests, sometimes we pass tests. God knows how to use even the failures in our life to cause us to grow in our understanding and how to walk with him. Because many times when there's failures in our life, it results in pain to us. We get to the point where we don't like the way the pain feels anymore. And what we do is that, see, he created us with a free will. Some people want a church where the preacher is going to just give you a whole bunch of rules and regulations. Like, we're a real simple folk preacher, and we just want you to tell us what we can do and what we can't do. That's not my job. My job is to teach you how to let Jesus be the pastor of your heart. Yeah. My job is to teach you how to have a relationship with the Lord and to how for you to be able to learn the Word of God, and that the Word of God would come onto the inside of your heart and begin to renew your mindset. I've said this many times before, but the children of Israel, because they had lived in Egypt for so long, were enculturated by the world around them. Meaning they had learned the ways of the Egyptians. Whenever we live in the world for so long, we begin to learn what the world says. See, we live in the midst of a society right now where they're basically trying to tell us or convince us that the Bible's outdated. They're even convincing many people in modern churches to change the translations of the Bible for various reasons. But not only that, to try to kind of take the edge off the message that you preach. Make the message what they call seeker sensitive. There's a lot of people that are seeking to find God. And if you say the wrong thing the wrong way, what you're going to do is you're going to repel them and you're going to make them leave. Okay? But the problem with that is this, is that, no, that's the world teaching that, and the modern church is embracing the ways of the world and trying to manipulate the Word of God and the way that church is done. Because you see, I've taught y'all this, the people in the church, this many times. The word for church
literally in the Greek language, and this is just to make a point. You don't have to worry about trying to learn Greek words here, but I do that for you, right? The word is for church in the Greek is ekklesia. The word ek is a preposition that means out. The word ecclesia is a word that means called. So what does it mean? It means called out. The church is a congregation of called out ones. So the question that we have to ask ourselves is, what was I called out of? Well, you were called out of the world. Called out of the world into his marvelous light. You used to be a child of darkness, born in the midst of darkness, but when you were born again, the light of God, the light that God sent from heaven to earth, Jesus, came to the inside of your heart, awakened your spirit to the things of God, opened your blinded. I was blind, but now I see. Amen. You were blind spiritually, but now the Holy Spirit has opened your eyes and allowed you to begin to see the things of God. But the world system around us, the pervasive spirit in the atmosphere is saying, oh no, you got to cater to everybody's needs. I wasn't going to tell y'all, but it's no big deal. I was going to do a little mini triathlon yesterday. So I was over there and ended up being a disaster. But anyway, I'm over there and they got the invocation. They got somebody to pray, because they always want to have somebody pray, you know. But then so your boy prays. He prays, Father, please protect everybody. And at the very end of the prayer, he did it. He went and he said, in Jesus' name we pray. I heard this guy standing on the side of me, you're not supposed to do that. They want, so what the world wants is everybody to be included. They don't want you to separate yourself. But that's what I'm here to tell you this morning is that is contrary to what the Bible teaches. The God that we serve is the one that sent Jesus. All these other religions say, and none of this is in my message this morning, but all these other religions say that there's many, that the way to get to God is that you do good works, and when you do good works, you prepare yourself in such a way that you can reach a certain level, and that you now get to enter into nirvana, you get to go to paradise, you get to go whatever, because you did what you were supposed to do. The Bible teaches something completely different. The Bible teaches that man is altogether undone, that God had to intervene in the midst of his circumstances, that God had to send his only begotten Son, the one who never sinned, the one who never failed, the one who was always obedient, to offer his sinless life on the cross as a sacrifice for our sin. And it's only our faith in that that allows his righteousness to be given to us as a gift. And now that making us able to enter into the presence of God. But you know what that message does? It causes people to have to come to grips with the fact that they are not right with God in their first birth, and that they must be born again. And that is, listen to me, your human mind, your human soul does not want to hear that kind of thing. What we want to hear is that we're okay, but the reality, that's what psychology would teach. No, you're okay, but that's not what the Bible teaches. And if we're going to keep on teaching the Bible, then we're going to have to tell the truth. I really did go off on a rabbit trail, but what I want you to know is that God has called us to be separated ones, called out ones. Amen. It doesn't mean that we get it right all the time, every day. But the reality of it is that if we will continue to follow the leading of the Lord, if we will continue to trust in his provision and what he's given, he Amen. Will begin to change us, and he will begin to cause us to look more like his darling son than we started off in this race. Amen? All right. Amen. And so he says, I'm going to rain bread from heaven for you, and the people shall go out and gather a certain rate every day, that I may prove them. I'm going to put them to the test. So that's where we went off. Put them to the test in the sense that we say that we're God's people, but at the same time, do we behave like God's people? So God allows tests to take place in our lives to prove and to reveal to us. He does it to the preacher too. You understand that? I mean, we're all in this together. Amen? We all have struggles. We all have tests. We all have temptations. Amen? But God is still saying, this is my word. And this is what I'm doing on this earth. And this is how I'm revealing myself, because I want to put you to the test. I want to show you what's in yourself. As a matter of fact, he said in Deuteronomy chapter 8, he said, 40 years I kept you in the wilderness to prove you, to test you, to show you what was in your own heart, to humble you in the way, See, the reality of it is that each and every one of us have things that we deal with, and many times prideful situations, right? And we can't even see, we don't even realize it, but our own heart is against the things of God. And God's over here desiring to provide certain things for us, and we think that we know better than God what's best for us, all right? And so he's saying, I'm going to rain bread from heaven for you, and the people shall go out. They're going to gather a certain rate every day. This is how much I want you to get. If you go back and you read the text, he tells us exactly. It's like an omer, which is about 2 quarts. I want you to go out there, and I want you to gather a certain amount every day, and I'm going to put them to the test. I'm going to see if they're going to do it the way I want them to do it. You know what I'm saying? I mean, the truth of the matter is that when we give our heart to the Lord, like, it's not like we don't ever do anything the way the Lord wants us to do it. But we know, but the whole time God's testing, are you going to do it my way? Like, for instance, well, give me something practical that I can chew on, preacher. Okay. I'll just use an example. Let me tell you something that I kind of struggle with. So because of the fact that by the grace of God, I got a decent job. I got a decent full job, too. I get paid a decent salary. So at the same time, I'd commute back and forth from Morgan City to Houma every day. So it doesn't make a whole lot of sense for me to go buy a brand new vehicle because, to be honest with you, I put 80 miles on a vehicle just in one day. All right. And so and this is something that I've struggled with, but I like the way new vehicles look. I like the way that they smell. There's a lot of vehicles out there that I feel like I can afford that I'd like to go buy. But there's something in me that tells me, that's not good wisdom. You should not go do that because of the particular situation that you're living. I'm telling you what the Lord showed me. I'm not telling you he told you that. If he told you you can go buy a brand new car and you can afford it, that's fine. Unfortunately, many times people buy a bigger car than what they got a paycheck. But that's another story. That's a financial message that we'll probably preach it and poke somebody in the eyeball, but we won't do that this morning. But the point that I'm trying to make is that what the Lord has revealed to me is what is good for Matt. And that's God's wisdom telling Matt that, but yet at the same time, Matt still struggles with it from time to time. Oh, but I'd still like to go get that. You understand what I'm getting at? And so even though the Lord's revealing it to me, and that's his voice, that's the Lord, because it's not Matt's flesh, because Matt's flesh say, no, I think the Lord wants me to go get this car. No, that's your flesh lying to you and telling you to go do something that the Lord told you not to do. And now you and I have to determine in our hearts what's the Lord and what's not. Amen. Many times I can tell you when the Lord speaks something to you that's contrary to what you want, it's probably God. It's probably God speaking to you, and your flesh is in a battle against that, right? And so that's what the Lord was doing here. I want you to gather a certain amount every day. I'm about to put you to the test. And to see, are they going to gather what I told them to gather, or are they going to get more? And then he ends up going on and telling them later on, don't leave it overnight. If you leave it overnight, I'm telling you what's going to happen is it's going to get stinky. And sure enough, they tried to do it. Because we're not going to read the whole text, but that's what they would do. They ended up gathering more than they were supposed to. They would leave it overnight. The next day, it stunk. It had worms in it. Okay, God made a point. Plus, not only that, when the sun came out, it began to melt it. So you had to get out there every day, and you had to gather it up, or else the sun was going to melt it. Then you couldn't take too much and try to leave it over for the next day, because if you did, it got stunky and it started to grow worms in it. And so, you know, the Lord was putting them in a situation where they had to trust him. They had to trust him in even minute circumstances, or else it was just going to get spoiled and the whole thing was going to turn into a mess. See, you can use that in your life today, I'm telling you. See, the Lord wants you and I to learn how to trust him, even in the small details of our life. Now, if we're going to pray to him and ask him for direction and ask him for wisdom, when he speaks to us, we can't go, we'll just use the preacher's little scenario. Lord, I want to do what's right with my finances. I don't know about you. Have you ever been in debt before? You don't have to raise your hand. Okay. But if you've ever been in debt before, and sometimes you get in debt to the point where you feel miserable about it, let me tell you something, that's not a fun place to be. I've been there before. And I prayed to the Lord, Lord, I don't like where I am right here with this. I need you to help me get out of here. Okay, you want me to help you get out? I'm going to give you some wisdom. I'm going to show you some things. I'm going to show you how you got to handle your business. But if you're not going to listen to me, it's kind of like with my kids, right? They're like, Dad, I want to be, she ain't in here, I want to be a better softball player. Well, baby, this is the hard fact. They got kids that got better skill than you. They just do. They were just born a little bit more coordinated, a little faster, got a better arm. They're just a little bit stronger. But guess what? If you work hard,
if you put in the time and you work hard, you can gain some skill level and you can pop. But guess what? So like a year later, we're still in the same place. Dad, I want to be a better. At some point, Tom will like talk to the hand because we've already had this conversation. The good news is that the Lord will never give you the hand to talk to. Amen. But at the same time, he's not going to keep on giving you instruction and direction whenever he's already given you instruction and direction. Right. And so that's what I was trying to say, is that the Lord in the preacher situation, if I want to get out of a financial situation but yet I keep on going buy brand new cars, I keep on buying this, keep on buying that. And it's like the Lord's like, I thought you wanted to get, which one is it that you want? You understand what I'm getting at? And so the Lord's putting them to the test. And even that, on the sixth day, so he's wanting to get involved in the minute details of our life. On the sixth day, he said, don't even go and gather any bread on that day. Don't get any manna on the sixth day. I want you to get a double portion on the sixth day. And he said, they shall prepare that which they bring in, and it shall be twice as much as they gather daily. Why? This is the first reference to the children of Israel and the Sabbath in the Bible. God mentions the Sabbath as a rest day when he created, but this is before the law was given. This is before the Ten Commandments. And he's already given a reference to it. He doesn't want them doing work on the seventh day. Once again, trust me. Trust me that if you'll gather what I tell you to gather, you'll have enough. Trust me that you need to get it enough for today and you're going to have enough. Trust me that you don't have to worry about overdoing it today, because if you try to, I'm telling you, it's going to get rotten tomorrow. Trust me that you can trust me, and that on the sixth day, you can get twice as much. And you don't have to go looking for it the next day. But you know what some of them did on the seventh day? They went looking for it. The Bible actually says, if you go on and read the story, some of them went out looking. There was none there. He didn't allow it to happen. See, what would happen is that every night, when the children of Israel went to sleep, God would allow it. It was like dew on the ground. They'd wake up in the morning and there it was. And all they had to do was to go pick it up and to gather the amount that God told them to gather. Now, I want to tell you, like, for sake of time, we're actually going to look at the text, but I got to get into my message. I haven't gotten into my message yet. But there's two other passages I wanted to talk to you about. One of them is very similar to this, out of Numbers chapter 11. Same scenario. Children of Israel are out of Egypt. They're in the wilderness. And it has to do with the manna. It has to do with the manna from heaven. But they get frustrated with God. And they start to murmur and complain. And what they want is, they're not just talking about flesh pots. They like, we want some flesh to eat. We want some quail to eat. We'll get into it a little bit more. But what God said was, you want quail? I'm going to give you some quail. And if you read behind commentators and scholars, the idea is that there's a migration of quail that come from Africa towards Palestine every year. And it's almost as though what God did was he changed the direction of the wind and he blew all them quail into their camp. And the idea is that they were flying about 3 feet off the ground, so much of it, that they were just knocking them down. And they had more flesh or meat, if you will, than they could even really tolerate. The Bible says that at some point in time, as they were eating, it's actually the King James says, ere they were chewing the meat in their mouth, meaning while it was going on, while they were chewing the meat in their mouth, God's anger and wrath hit them, and the plague hit the camp, and it began to, they actually began to die in the midst of the camp. God's judgment came on them. So in that particular circumstance, they're murmuring because they're not happy with what God is giving them. The last passage of scripture comes out of John chapter 6. Like I said, we are going to cover them. We're going to look at them a little bit closer before it's over with. But in John chapter 6, Jesus is having a discourse with the religious leaders of the day. So now we're like 1,500 years later. The children of Israel is about 1,500 BC. Jesus is around 30, 33 AD. Amen? And so we're looking at 1,500 years later. But the children of Israel know all of these stories. They know what their people did in the past. They know how they didn't listen to God because they have the scriptures to read. And so Jesus sits down, if you'll remember, and he performed a miracle where there was a young boy who had three fish and five loaves. You remember that story? And he multiplied it and he fed the multitude. They wanted to make him a king. They wanted to right at that point in time, they wanted him to save them from the Roman Empire is what they really wanted. They didn't want to be saved from their sins. They wanted what they wanted. And Jesus realized that, and they were causing a big commotion. He sent his disciples over to the other side of the Sea of Galilee,
And that's when he went and walked on water towards them. But he was trying to get his disciples out of there because, you know, the truth of the matter is that whenever we're around people that have a different plan, and many times they sit in the church, and that is part of a message this morning. They sit in the church, or there's people on the outside that we're Facebook friends with, or people that we're friends with. They're like, oh, I'm a Christian. But yet their mindset and their understanding of the Bible is completely different than what's written in here. And they will begin to influence us. They will call into question our convictions based upon what we learn from the scripture. And what ends up happening is it can begin to influence our understanding and our relationship with the Lord. God didn't want his disciples influenced by what they were saying, so Jesus sent them onto the other side, and later he went and walked on water. Now, when they realized that he left, they followed him over there. And what Jesus ended up telling them was, you didn't follow me because you saw the miracles. Well, yeah, they saw him, Jesus. The word in the Greek there doesn't mean physically saw, but that you perceived the miracles. See, you can. A lot of people want signs and wonders regarding their Christianity, but the reality of it is this, is that what true New Testament Christianity is doing? A work on the inside of our heart. But not just to please what we see on the outside. Amen. And so Jesus said, you don't follow me because you saw the miracles or properly perceived that I am the one that God promised, but instead because your bellies were filled. He met a need that they had. And many times people's Christianity is built on a very superficial level, and they just want what they want to get out of the situation, if that makes sense. And as soon as God starts doing something in their life and they get everything back together to where they feel like it's in a good spot, they out of there, and here the Lord is left, you know, continuously. They're backing out on the Lord, right? And I don't say that to be mean, because I know that we all have a tendency to do that kind of thing, and you know, it's in all of us. But so what ends up happening is he ends up getting in this discussion with these religious leaders, and they say, "Hey, what kind of sign will you show us?" And he says, "I mean, he just multiplied bread and fish, but that's not good enough. What kind of sign will you show us? Moses caused manna to rain from heaven." And you know what the Lord told him? Moses didn't give you that bread from heaven. My Father gives you the true bread. For I am the bread that comes from heaven. I am the bread of life. If any man will eat of this bread, then he will have life. Amen? And that's actually, he says, my flesh is true meat. My blood is true drink. That's where some people in the Catholic religion have taken that scripture. And I mean, I'm just here to tell you the truth. You go to other churches and they don't even want to mention this because they're scared there's going to be Catholic people sitting in the audience and you're going to offend them. I'm here just to tell the truth, period. I was born and raised Catholic. If I want to talk about it, I will. Because I went to catechism, and you know what? The priest kicked me out. Okay? But it wasn't his fault. I was a bad kid. All right. But this is the story on that. They say, see, that this scripture right here, Jesus said, his flesh is true meat, his blood is true drink. That's why we transubstantiate. Some kind of magical hocus pocus, something's going on there that's turning it into the literal flesh. That's not what Jesus is saying. If you go back and you read the end of chapter 6, he said, the flesh profits. He says, the words that I speak to you, they are truth and life. The flesh profits nothing. It's the spirit that brings life. He's trying to say that, and I don't want to get ahead of myself, but the same way you eat food, you got it. It's a spiritual thing. You got to bring Jesus into you. The point that I'm trying to make is this, is that in each one of these scenarios, we have very similar concepts going on. God's desiring to provide for his people, amen, in the Old Testament and even in Jesus, but yet the people don't want what it is that God is providing. And they begin to murmur and they begin to complain because they want it to be done their own way. As a matter of fact, in the New Testament passage, whenever Jesus says that you're either going to eat my flesh and drink my blood or you'll have none of me, the Bible says that from that moment moving forward, many of the disciples left him and chose not to walk with him anymore. So whenever Jesus says hard things, the crowd begins to break up and disperse. All right. So essentially, that's the idea of what's going on. God wants to provide for his people, but unfortunately, many times, the people don't really want what God provided. So I titled my message this morning, "Can you take this back to the kitchen, please?" Have you ever been to the restaurant and they bring you out something and, you know, you didn't really like the way that it was presented, or you didn't like a particular aspect of it? And I don't know if you ever did this or not, but you see, at least see it on movies, and they say, can you please take this back to the kitchen? I like some of those movies where it's like some French chef back there and he's chopping up some carrots and he starts to have a fit over the whole thing, right? Oh, they call into question my creation, you know? And I can imagine that, you know, the Lord sometimes gets pretty upset too. Like, here I've gone through this process of preparing a plan, and my people who I have called to have a relationship with me, I'm over here giving them what I know is best for them, but the reality of it is that they don't want what it is that I'm providing for them. So can you take this back to the kitchen, please? Because in reality, that's what's happening across the board in all of these stories, is that God's providing, but the people don't really want what it is that he's provided. Well, my point number one under that title is finish your plate. Because you see, the reality is that just as a parent would put good food on a plate, at least a good parent, right, would put good food on a plate that would have good nutritional value for their child. Now, I can remember my daddy saying, boy, you know what, you can get as much as you want, but you sure better eat what you take, right? Well, some of that was, I guess, kind of messed up, because what daddy should have told me was, no, we need to eat our food in proper portion size. and we need to make sure it's of proper nutritional value, because that's why Brother Matt was so chunky when he was a little boy. Because, you know, I'll buy you as much food as what you want, but you better make sure you clean that plate. Well, the reality, the concept is supposed to be, though, that a good parent is going to provide good, nutritious food for their child, because they want them to grow up strong and they want them to grow up healthy. And so the idea is, no, eat your spinach, eat your broccoli, finish what's on your plate. What I'm trying to tell you is that we must be able to trust that what God is serving us is good for us. Amen. In this scenario, the children of Israel, talking about the first passage that we read, have been delivered from Egyptian bondage. They were previously slaves. They're on their way to freedom. And while on the journey, they complain on more than one occasion. Where's the food we're going to eat? Where's the water that we're going to drink? God has to actually cause water to come from a rock. That's what he chooses to do. He wants water to come from a rock, because even in the New Testament, they say that Jesus was a type of that rock. You're thirsty in your walk upon this journey of earth. Guess what? There was a rock that followed them around in the wilderness. The Apostle Paul said that rock was Jesus, and out of that rock flowed living water. And Jesus said in the Gospel of John, I provide living water. If any man or woman drink of this water that I provide, you will never thirst again. So in the Old Testament, he's over here desiring to meet their physical needs, which are types and shadows of, in the New Testament, the fact that God is desiring to meet our spiritual needs, and he will also meet our physical needs, amen, if we will continue to trust him and walk according to his will. So if you're thirsty spiritually, guess what? He's got water for you to drink. If you're hungry spiritually, guess what? He's got food for you to drink, but you got it. Food for you to eat, but you got to be willing to eat what it is that God is providing. He chose to rain manna from heaven. He provided that what they needed. Amen. But you know, there's no doubt that the way that God created man with a free will, and then you mix that with the fall, man's got his own way of doing things now. He's got his own mindset, right? I mean, hey, God, I mean, in other words, I got some wisdom too. I got some logic. I can make some decisions in the midst of this situation. And so we begin to use our own wisdom to talk us out of trusting in the wisdom of God. And that was the whole point to that part of the passage. The point to that part of the passage had to do with the fact that God said, I'm going to put this stuff out here for you. I want you to gather exactly this much. I want you to trust me each day in the midst of your life that I'm going to provide for you. I don't want you to gather too much. I don't want you to leave it overnight. If you do, it's going to spoil. And the same thing in your life and in my life, God's wanting us to trust him each and every day as we go through the journey of life, and not to try to go off and to do it our own way. And as he puts us to the test, to trust that we're going to believe him in the midst of these situations. But at the same time, if you could put 1 Corinthians 3:19 up, man, because of his own wisdom, comes up in the midst with his own plan. And so it says right here in 1 Corinthians 3:19, for the wisdom of this world is foolishness with God, for it is written, He takes the wise in their own craftiness. What does that mean? It means that man has his own wisdom since God gave him a free will. There's a spirit out there. I've told you about that. We talked about that already. That mankind has his own wisdom contrary to the word of God. And man will try to fix and remedy his own situation. But whenever we do that, we end up setting a trap for ourselves because we're going against God's will and God's plan and God's wisdom. And we find out, we end up creating a mess for our own selves. In Psalm chapter 81, verse 10, if you got your Bibles, you can turn there. This is what the Lord wants us to do. He wants us to trust him. Now, Psalms was written after, you know, the Exodus experience. But they're remembering it. As the people of God, they're remembering it. God said to them, he said, I am the Lord your God, which brought you out of Egypt. Open your mouth wide, and I will fill it. God's saying, I will feed you. I will provide for you. Hey, listen, I'll put this on your plate. I want you to finish the plate. I want you to trust me each and every day with the minute details of your life. Even in the New Testament, Luke 12, 24, the Word of God says this. Consider the ravens, for they neither sow nor reap. What does that mean? Consider the raven. It's a bird, right? Bird that flies in the air. It says they don't sow nor reap. In other words, they're not tilling the ground. They're not putting seed in the ground. They don't know how to harvest the field. But they neither have storehouse or barn. But yet God feeds them. How much more are you better than the fowls? This is Jesus talking. Jesus is talking to the multitudes in the New Testament, and he's trying to tell those that are going to follow after him, those that are going to be the children of God, that they are to learn to trust him and to trust in the provision that he provides. Amen. To the children of Israel, in the first passage of scripture we read, he gave specific instructions on how they were to gather. In other words, each day, they were supposed to get just enough for that day. If you could put Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 through 7. Now, why do you think that they might have gathered more than what God told them to gather? I mean, if you had to guess in your mind, I mean, this is, I don't mind if y'all talk back.
Greed
could be one reason.
Fear.
Did somebody say fear?
Yeah.
Fear, that's a good one. Why? Just fear that it won't be any there tomorrow.
Amen.
That, you know, I know he said it would be there, but what if it's not? Then what am I going to do, right? I kind of think it could be a little bit of both. I think it probably is a little bit of both, to be perfectly honest with you. But Philippians 4, 6 through 7 says, be careful for nothing. Really, the word careful there in the original language means anxious. So you can see somebody over there like biting their fingernails, right? And you've seen people nervous about things before, right? And how they could visibly shaking over it. And I'm not trying to make fun of that because everybody, but the reality of it is that the Word of God says, don't be anxious for anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication. In other words, when you have a concern or a problem, bring it to the Lord. With thanksgiving, let your request be made known to God. Well, Lord, I don't have enough manna for my family. Trust me. I got more month than I got in money. Trust me. Continue to trust me and listen to my wisdom. I'll give you a plan, but you're going to have to walk according to my plan. He says, and the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. So when you find yourself in the midst of situations and circumstances, instead of you being overly anxious, trying to grab a hold of your own wisdom to remedy your situation, you're to bring your situation before the Lord, allow the Lord to give you a peace, amen, and wisdom to go in the right direction. And guess what? When you trust after him and you listen to his voice, you know what's going to happen? Scripture says he's going to give you a peace that surpasses understanding. You know what that means? It means your situation may not have changed. It means that everything might still be just as messed up today as it was yesterday. It doesn't mean God can't change it. God can change it overnight. He can change it like that. I've seen him do stuff like that. Mm-hmm. But he sometimes proves us. He puts us to the test. And whenever we will trust him in the midst of the trial, one thing that he will oftentimes change many, many times when we're just trusting him. Like when we get to the place of surrender. You ever been there? Lord, I can't fix this. He's trying to get all of us there, including the preacher. Lord, I can't fix this. There's nothing I can do. Because can I tell you something? As long as you can fix it, you're probably going to try to do that. Even though I tried my best to explain it to you this morning, again, can I tell you another thing? I'm probably going to run into a situation tomorrow too where that's going to be the trial. Can you fix it? You understand what I'm getting at? And as long as you have the strength to fix it, until we really learn the lessons of life, we're probably going to try to fix it ourselves. But sooner or later, we're going to get tired of trying to fix it. And then when we get there and we're just, Lord, I can't fix it, I give this to you, all of a sudden, a peace that surpasses understanding. What I'm talking about is God's presence shows up. When God's presence shows up, it's a game changer. It changes everything. The situation hasn't changed, but now he's ministering to my heart. I can feel the presence of God, amen? He's doing a work in me, and he's strengthening me, and he's encouraging me in the midst of this situation. If I would just learn how to trust God, and to allow God to do what it is that God does. Amen? Number two, he said, don't gather extra and leave it for the next day. And we already talked about it, but when they did that, it became rotten. It bred maggots. The truth is that you can't work your way into right standing through the things of God. In other words, that's a doctrine that's been around since I first got saved. I'm not going to finish my message this morning, so let's just relax. Amen. We're just going to preach until about 11 o'clock, and then we're going to shut it down. Amen. Well, the Lord's already spoken what he wanted to speak this morning, I believe. But so what we're going to say is this, is that, you know, there's been a doctrine in the church when I first got saved that said this. It said, you know, you gave your heart to the Lord. You made the best decision of your life. Now you got some stuff that you got to do to clean yourself up. And I got to tell you something, that is a lie from the pit of hell. You cannot work hard enough in the church. You can't do enough works to clean yourself up. You hear what I'm trying to tell you? And so what I would do is, I'm over here thinking to myself, man, I got to, yesterday I think I only read one chapter. My goal was to read three. I got to read four chapters today. And so I'm over here creating rules and regulations and setting standards for myself. And when I fall short, I feel as though I've fallen short of the glory of God. But the reality of it is that Matt's reading schedule was never the standard of God's righteousness. Jesus was the standard of God's righteousness. And God sent Jesus to do away with Matt's sinfulness and to allow an exchange to take place where God gave the gift of Jesus's righteousness to Matt, and if Matt would just learn to trust in that, now grace flows. See, grace is like great. Where there's grace, there's peace. We were just talking about peace. And what I was trying to tell you is it's like a soft, gentle breeze that blows in and it changes everything. Well, whenever you know that the peace of God shows up in the midst of a situation, you know it's because God's grace showed up in the midst of the situation. God's grace works off of faith. We talked about that Wednesday night whenever we taught on the book of Ephesians. God's grace, where you have faith, not just any kind of faith. Listen to me. It's real clear. It's real important that we get this right. And you know, sometimes people think I'm a little too technical, but no, I'm not. Because you can have faith. See, faith. Yeah, the Bible says this. The Bible says that faith is the substance of things hoped for with the evidence of things unseen. In other words, I got to put my faith in something that I can't see. I got to trust in something that I can't see. You ever heard the difference between abstract and concrete art? I'm just kind of talking from my heart right now. Faith is kind of an abstract concept. I used to like Monet. I went to go see some of his stuff at the museum. You know, he was going blind and he painted the water lilies and all that. I thought that stuff looked really pretty, but it was abstract art. My mom used to paint abstract. That's why I knew a little bit about that. Versus concrete, definite lines. Faith sometimes can be an abstract concept, but it really shouldn't be as abstract as what we make it. Let me tell you why. Because the Bible is real clear what our faith is supposed to be in. We talked about the fact before in the church that when you get saved, you are now introduced into the faith. The word "the" right there makes faith a noun. What does that mean? The faith. It means you now have become part of a community of believers. You now have a common union with a group of people on the earth. What is that common union? Jesus Christ and what he did for you at the cross. What are you talking about? The first birth in Adam puts you in common union with the entirety of the world. We were all born of Adam, born in sin, but we're the called out ones. God sent his gospel to prepare a message to let people know I'm sending my son. He told us thousands of years in advance. Whenever he sent his son, your faith, which is a verb, it's an action. Even though you can't see it, you're not seeing yourself doing something, you're believing. Some people have used the terminology. One scholar I used to study behind talked about faithing, living a life of faithing. In other words, it's an action word. I'm putting my faith in God, not just one time. Yes, one time, the first time for salvation, but each and every day. Just as the children of Israel going out each and every day, faithing that God was going to have the manna on the ground, faithing that all they had to do was to get two omers, one omer, which is about 2 quarts, faithing that God was going to provide for their needs each and every day. In that similar fashion, the truth is that my action faith has to rest upon a particular object. And when that happens, I'm going to tell you what the object is. When that happens, it now puts me into the faith. Does that make sense? Now I become part of a body of believers. And when I know I draw this a lot, but for some of the people that maybe are here the first time, we talk about this a lot. We talk about the fact that we were born in our first birth in Adam. That's who that is right there. That's Adam. He's broken. He's dead. He's not happy. He's not alive to the things of God. And in your first birth in Adam, that's exactly what you were born into. I don't want to hear about, yeah, but I ain't never killed nobody. I ain't never did that. No, you were born in sin in Adam. We're all born in the same boat. Maybe your sin wasn't as nasty and ugly as my sin, but we were all born sinners. And if Jesus doesn't intervene and we don't put our faith in what he did to intervene, we're all going split hell wide open, and that may not be popular preaching in the modern church, but Jesus preached on sin and he preached on hell. Then he said it was a place you don't want to go. He said it was a place where there would be gnashing of teeth, where the worm doesn't die, where the fire isn't quenched. There's a place that you don't want to go, and it's a place that I don't want to go. And the people that are going to go there are those that have rejected the gospel message of Jesus Christ. Well, how can that be fair? Oh, don't get me started, because I've already thought it through. I've talked to physics majors. I've talked to rocket scientists, literally people that work for NASA. I've talked to them, and you know what? They're real smart. But the reality of it is this. Listen to me. God has always communicated his plan since the beginning, even in the midst of the garden, according to the word of God. And don't try to go get archaeological on me, because I've already studied all that stuff too. God has always, I believe this book, and according to this book, he has always communicated his plan to a lost and a dying world. But let me tell you something. You think that the tribe in Africa's in a bind because they've never heard the gospel? No, God has sent plenty of missionaries to Africa. But not only that, there was a group of people known as Noah's sons. I'm going off right here, but I just felt like I got to do it. Noah's sons, Ham, Shem, and Japheth. The descendants of Ham, they come, that's towards Africa. And let me tell you something. Ham was cursed of God. Ham's offspring, Canaan, was cursed of God. And all the descendants of Ham were cursed of God. Because guess what? Not just because of what happened in that incident, but also because they were not the people of God. They rejected the plan of God at that early stage of human history. God's been slowly turning the light on. It's almost like there was a dimmer switch. And he's slowly been turning the light on, and he was only holding people responsible for the amount of light that they were given. And along the way, people have rejected the amount of light that was given. And when you reject light, brothers and sisters, let me let y'all a little secret. It doesn't just affect you, it affects people around you. Entire nations, entire tribes of people, entire cities have been blinded and continue to sit in the midst of darkness because people have rejected the gospel of Jesus Christ. I had a conversation with one family member one time, and I knew his story because he was a part of the, my wife's family. And the truth is that, guess what? People had been telling this fella about Jesus for years, but he refused to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. And because of that, his children did not hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. And I told him, because he was coming against it. He's like, well, people, he was calling me into question about the tribe and all that stuff, like I was just telling you. And I told him this. I said, listen to me, sir. I said, the fact of the matter is that people rejected the gospel that could have brought that message to that tribe. God is communicating the same thing. God has been communicating the truth, but mankind in the hardness of his heart rejects the gospel. And when man rejects the gospel, there are deleterious effects. You can say that that's not fair, but no, God is the potter. We are the clay. And he has a way that he is revealing himself to people. And I use that as an example to tell him, because of the fact that you have rejected the gospel of Jesus Christ, your children also have not heard the gospel. And now, guess what? Their children have not heard the gospel. And there's a possibility that their children may not hear the gospel. But God is so good. God is so good that he'll bring somebody along, amen, to tell the truth. Praise God. He'll bring somebody along to reveal truth. And so I want to finish this concept right here. The faith. So what is the object of my faith? The object of my faith is that God had a plan. And what was that plan? Ultimately, it was Jesus. Even way back in the Old Testament, God revealed to mankind that he was sending Jesus. Amen? Not just Jesus, who he was, but Jesus, what he did. Jesus dying on the cross. The Bible says, Paul says, we preach Christ crucified. Well, what does that even mean, preacher? I know I've said it probably 5 times already, but let me just say it one more time. When you put your faith in Jesus Christ and what he did for you at the cross. See, all that bread on the ground, them going to get it every day, that was all a type of you and I trusting in Jesus each and every day. Not just for our initial salvation, but each and every day. Trusting in what God provided so that grace can flow into our lives and grace changes us. When we put our faith in Jesus and what he did for us at the cross, the righteousness of God, which is Jesus, is given to us. Because we're in the righteousness of God, guess what? We have access to grace. And as grace is flowing in our lives, he's strengthening us. He's changing us. And the peace of God is being manifest in the midst of our lives.